around and hello everyone. My name is Jonathon Dornbush and this is a very special and strange episode of Podcast Beyond, IGN's weekly PlayStation show covering all the latest and greatest in the world of PlayStation in person. We're doing an entire show in person. I was like, is everyone going to just stay silent?
I'm leaving.
Okay. We're doing this all in person. It's really fun. This is episode 750. We've reached that amazing 750 milestone.
Did we actually manage to do something special for like this episode?
Kind of,
I feel like we always drop the ball.
Yes, but the bar is so low now that special for us is just what regular used to be.
Right.
Yeah, this is what we normally did 2 years ago. It is now special.
We showed up.
Yeah, we all showed up. And yeah, for those listening to the audio version, we're all in the same space for this week's episode. We're all recording in the IGN SF studio. It's very exciting for us. My name is Jonathon Dornbush, if I didn't say that earlier, and I'm joined this week, going from left to right, by Brian Altano.
Can I do something I haven't done in a couple of years?
Go for it.
Beyond!
Beyond! Thank you so much, Brian. We're also joined this week by Jada Griffin.
Hello, hello! Beyond 750, baby!
We're also joined by Max Scoville.
Hey, Beyond.
Beyond.
This is weird.
It is.
This is so weird. I don't know what to do. What are those people in the TV down there?
Those are mirror Smart. Versions
Where do
of
I
ourselves.
Look? What do I do with my hands? I don't know what to do.
We're going to spend half this episode just wondering what we do with ourselves.
Yeah, this is deeply surreal, but I'm glad to be back.
Yeah.
It's a treat.
It's super fun to all be together, to do an episode together in the studio. We do actually have big PlayStation news to talk about this week because we got the PlayStation Plus first part of the lineup for the new PlayStation Plus that we're going to go into. But, before we get into that, one, I do have some housekeeping from last week that I want to quickly go over. And then two, I want to just check in with the boys who haven't been on in a while. But before we do that, Jada, obviously I asked you and Brian and Max used to love these just so much. I asked you a trophy test question. Toffees or coffees?
Toffee. I thought you had
toffees.
Oh no, I wish I did.
Wait,
he said we used to love these. I don't know. Does he have
toffees for us? Wait, are there people that used to love toffees?
And they don't anymore?
In the before times, he'd always bring those delicious caramels on the set and let us have them as
that
a treat.
Seems like a thing you build up to over time. Like the older you get, the more you're excited about toffee.
By a Werther's original on set. I think
we've all put on like 5 or 6 years in the last two.
Yeah, that's very true. Fair.
I am 72 now. No, but Jada, I asked you a trophy test question last week about unpacking. And I want your answer. Was the real trophy on guard or was it, why can't I remember the name? Damn it. I had this all set up and then was it Bust a Move?
I don't know. It might have been.
No, you're probably right. Here we go. On guard or strike a pose.
Strike a pose?
Oh, I actually know this one.
What is it?
Strike a pose.
It's strike a pose.
Yeah. It is strike a pose. You're both correct. Unfortunately, Cahal, a fan of the show who got it right the first week, did not get this one right, unfortunately, but thank you for writing in. But yes, you were correct. So you continue your winning streak against Mark, who isn't here to even guess.
Go play that game, by the way. That game is very nice.
Unpacking
it's wonderful.
Amazing.
Unless you just moved. Like there was actually a bunch of friends of mine that I was like, you got to play this game. And they're like, I literally just moved. And I'm like, just open up the crap in your house.
I still have boxes from my last move. So yeah, it's a little like cathartic, but also scary. But yes, Jada, you continue your winning streak. We'll see if Mark can even get one right next week, but we'll find out what happens. But
Mark's not coming back.
He's never coming back.
He's never coming back.
But before we find out if Mark comes back at some point, Brian and Max, how are you guys doing?
I'm good. We should say that the reason Mark can't come back is he is at Disney and Splash Mountain stopped at the top.
And he's just
and
been there.
He's just at the precipice of the waterfall.
Yeah.
And so we're all standing by. We're waiting. We will keep you updated on whether or not he makes it past Brer Rabbit's Briar Patch to the basin.
But they're changing it. So it's like half removed robots. It's like virtually Briar is there.
You know what? I think he's living his best life up there, though. Like he's just, you know.
That is the best part, you know?
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
The animatronics are not working from the bottom up. So their legs are wiggling, but otherwise they're perfectly still.
That is a nightmare, which Jada may have after this show now.
I probably will.
No, things are good. Things are good. All things considered, we're all happy, healthy. We're in our brand new studio here in San Francisco.
Yes.
Which is awesome. Things are different now, obviously. Like IGN is not a building that you come into and there's like 150 people all yelling and saying, what are you playing today? Or what are you doing? It's quieter now. And so things are starting to get back and people are starting to get back in the office. And that's cool to see. I'm trying to come in once a week, twice a week, working from home. But otherwise, things are great.
I really, I like the idea that the old doorman would be like, "What are you playing?" when you came into the room.
Just a Jerry?
Yeah, Jerry would ask, "What are you playing?
What are you buying?"
Yeah. But Max, how are you doing?
I'm doing all right. I feel like I haven't been on the show in a year. How long is it? Do you have any idea?
It probably was last year. Yeah, at some point. Yeah.
It's been. Yeah, no, I've been good. Played a lot of Elden Ring. I have a child who's like more kid-like than baby-like at this point. Like, she's rapidly growing, which is definitely a thing that, you know, occupied a lot of my time. Luckily, I played Death Stranding, which was good preparation for my child and going to the UPS store, you know, so there's that. But
yeah,
nothing's good. It is, again, incredibly surreal to be here in person, but it's, you know, it's a good thing. Felt like the first day of school today, like before. I don't like school, you know, like when it's not like a chore to go there, you're just like, oh boy, I get to see people. Yeah. Hooray.
I should warn you that there are six bullies that live here now and they're going to kick all of our butts.
Well, I hope they don't take my new backpack.
They are going to put it on the flagpole because you're a big tweet.
And yeah, a lot has changed. I'm actually four of those bullies. So
that is true.
Yes. Yeah.
I'm sorry.
You have to hit the gym. You know, it happens.
Jonathon has made the transformation. He's in his final form.
Into bully. Yeah.
To bully. Yes. Yeah. He's a super senior.
Maybe it'll come to the PlayStation Plus lineup. Bully. We'll find out. That was a transition. No, before we get to that, I do actually want to ask, I want to put you both on the spot because Jada, Mark, and I put ourselves out there, made fools of ourselves by making predictions about a non-existent PlayStation Summer Showcase. It has not been announced. It has not been confirmed in any way. We're just hopeful and really wanting there to be a showcase because we miss them. So with that said, I wanted to ask both of you to put on the record so that the commenters in the future can laugh or be amazed at us. I want to hear either a date or a week. I'll take, you know, something as broad as a week, as when you think the PlayStation Summer Showcase, if there is one, will happen, and then give me two games or parts of the presentation you think are going to happen.
Can I look at a calendar?
Yes, please do.
Okay, because I don't want to pick like a Sunday afternoon.
No, for sure. Yeah, I took May 30th, the final, like, I think it's like a Monday or Tuesday of the month.
Yeah.
Leading up to a couple weeks before, you know, when we would normally expect an E3 type of showcase, and a week, just about a week after the PS Premium goes live, because we all saw we got a blog post, we got a, you know, blog post about it. So I'm like, now's a good time for them to. That's a good time for them to.
May 30th.
Yeah.
The week of or that day.
I said that day.
That's Memorial Day.
Is it? Oh yeah, they're definitely not doing that. I do not pay attention to holidays then. So I do look like a fool.
I mean, to be fair, Xbox is making us come into work on a Sunday for their showcase.
That's true.
So anything's possible. And I, for reference, I did the end of June because I will be out on vacation then. So it is most likely to happen when I'm not in the studio.
Oh, was my okay. Thought.
But anyway, Brian, I'll start with you.
I think June 22nd, which is June a Wednesday.
22nd. I like it.
I picked that because my brain originally went to a Sunday morning that week, so I'm glad I looked. As for games, I think Deathloop. No.
DLC trailer, maybe?
It's got to be God of War. We have to see God of War. But yeah. This is all eyes are on them right now. We have had big AAA flagship games delayed from their biggest competitors, and obviously none of us want to see that happen to God of War, but it feels like we got that update from Corey recently. Mm-hmm. Like it feels like there's stuff to show soon. And even if that does come with a delay, which will break my heart, we'll get to see more of it. And I think that's what matters most.
Yeah.
And of course, Deathloop, just a little bit, just a little slide in there.
Yeah.
Do you think they're going to be, if they do get it this year, they're going to be petty and take that 11/11 date that everybody's been talking about online?
The Starfield date?
The Starfield date, take the old Starfield date.
Man,
that would be funny. But
I would hope that the, you know, the story of the first God of War was that Kratos learned not to be that vindictive and mean about it. But who knows? He is a God of War.
Old habits die hard.
Yeah, he is. He's going to be dealing with another God of War in this game because of Tyr. So maybe he's got to be petty to win. Mm-hmm. Max, what about you?
I'm going to say June 15th.
Okay.
Yeah.
Dab in the middle.
Smack dab in the middle. Safe bet. Just throw
the
it down.
The Ides
bullseye.
Of June.
Yeah.
What day is that?
That's a Wednesday.
Okay.
Okay.
And if it's not on that Wednesday, but it is that week, then I meant that week.
What day is Jeff Keighley's Big Summer Sausage Fest or whatever?
Is that the sequel to the Seth Rogen movie?
Isn't it the 12th or something? I don't know.
Xbox is the 12th. I think it's the 10th.
10th?
Maybe it's earlier. We have no idea what day it is.
It's not like we have to plan a bunch of programming
There are people in their cars listening. Jeff Keighley's in his car screaming the date. He's just banging the steering wheel.
There's no sausage involved.
We are a meatless family here. No, it is live. June 9th is the Summer Game Fest.
Okay.
Digital event. So yeah, that's what it said on Google. So yeah, we'll have that.
Definitely makes sense to wait after Xbox, Microsoft, because if they come out swinging with something that maybe Sony wants to counter it, I don't know. I have nothing to go on. I'm just completely pulling this out of my ass.
That worked for them in the Adam Boys, Shuhei Yoshida handoff video.
Trading games,
I was thinking about that the other day, about how that, like, how, A, their messaging has been infinitely more convoluted than it was back then when they're shooting iPhone videos in the back of a lobby or whatever.
Yeah.
But B, like, how that moment pretty much won the generation for them. And now things, you know, like, things are a little closer with everybody, but like, I would still love to see something like that now, just like something that raw and goofy.
That'd be great.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But well, no, instead we get like how to upgrade your HD version to the PS5 version. It's like a 4-step process with pricing.
Install Linux.
Well, you're totally right, because it was such a different time. I totally agree with you. I think, you know, even people buying PS4s 5 years down the line obviously don't know about that video probably as much, but like that single moment, I think, was the inflection point for that generation for a lot of people. But it also speaks to, that was a time where, like, you just saying Adam and Shuhei is very immediate to PlayStation fans of that time. Mm-hmm. But for now, it's like I think the only two, like, Shuhei is obviously still there and doing such great work championing indies. But then it's Herman occasionally makes appearances, and then there's Jim, who puts his foot in his mouth sometimes, and it's not great. And so, it's like a different era of PlayStation. I don't think having a name or a person as associated with them in that way.
Yeah.
Especially not in the way that, like, Xbox has Phil.
Well, it's also like it's weird to have a summer showcase thing, because the last two summer showcases have dropped in like September.
Yeah.
I mean, that first year when we were all just, I mean, that first awful pandemic year, we're just like, we didn't know what was going on. And we're like, so is the PS5 coming out this year? And they didn't tell us anything. And we were waiting to find out about pre-orders and, like, really, what was it? And didn't they wait until, was that in June, or was that?
No, so they had a May, like, early showcase for games.
Okay.
And I think it was May or very early June. And then they did a September, which is where they did the date, the reveal of the, maybe that was the reveal of the console.
It all blurs together. But, like, again, I remember we were kind of tearing our hair out, being like, what are we supposed to talk about? Like, what are we doing here? And it was very weird that they were just so quiet about it.
I don't know. That's why I'll always miss E3, because at the very least it created a consolidated expectation of what that week could look like.
It's a due date for everyone to turn in their homework assignments.
Exactly. Yes.
And now it's like, I mean, the thing is that's sort of both liberating but also confusing and, you know, scattering, is now if you want to own the conversation, you know, you reveal your new next gen VR hardware on a Tuesday morning when nothing else is going on.
In May.
And then everyone's just like, oh, well, this is all we're talking about this week. And as opposed to doing it in this one just, you know, nonstop kind of deluge of news drops that happens with E3. And it's sort of, and if you, I mean, it sucks, because if you are sort of more casual internet fan, gamer, like, E3 was great, 'cause you could kind of dip in and be like, what'd I miss?
Yeah.
You know, like, what's going on? What's happening? I got shit to do. I can't just be like, you know, reading blogs every day or whatever.
It was very clearly like this, everyone was celebrating video games around the same time. And people were turning their homework in, and sometimes that homework wasn't ready. And I don't know, the pencil would fall through the geometry of the paper. But it does feel like, you know, when they shoot Liquid Terminator and it just spills into like 100 pieces, and you're like, are you going to come back together and make a person again? Or are you just going to be piles in the corner? Because right now we have a bunch of disparate piles in the corner, right? There's a bunch of like little silver blobs, and you're like, well, that's Microsoft's thing. They actually, and they were like, here's our day.
Yeah.
This is our time. And that's like, that's E3 week. So that they were the first ones to be sort of like, we're still doing this. Is everybody else still doing this? So I hope that Nintendo and Sony also go, yeah, we are.
I think that's like a Dawn of the Dead, where like the zombies go back to the mall because that's what they did in their lifetime. Like, they don't know what else to do. It's just where they go.
Yeah. So just to make sure, before anyone probably paused the episode and then commented, June was the 2020 showcase. That was when they showed games off for the first time, like Horizon and Miles and all that. And then it was September. And then the year after, in 2021, I always mix these up, but May was the Horizon Forbidden West state of play, when it was still coming out last year. And then they did a state of play in July, and then the showcase in September. And I think by like that September showcase was Spider-Man, Wolverine, KOTOR. And
that was
that was a good showcase.
That was awesome.
Sorry, Red. That's the weird thing that I think a lot of people have started to adjust to is like when Sony says a state of play, you don't expect the first party drops like that. Yeah. When they say showcase, that's when we get those big things now.
Well said.
And that could change, but that's kind of where we're at. So we're hoping for something this summer, but
so what you're saying is that their sort of PR marketing presentation model has the same number of tiers as the new PlayStation Plus.
It does.
Yes. So there's like the premium ultra plus showcase, and then there's the, you know, the premier summer straight.
I locked into 14 years of Wolverine, which is just, I only get to get Wolverine showcases and only get Wolverine the game when it comes
that
out.
That would be great.
I'm locked out of every other game on my
side. Does it come with like comics and like pajamas and stuff?
I cheaped out, so you only get one of his adamantium clothes, which is weird.
Yeah. You know what? But I feel like that would be really helpful, like in the kitchen when you're cooking.
Oh my god! Yeah,
like super easy for like when you're chopping.
I grill a lot, so that's super easy kebab stuff there.
Perfect.
Yeah. Put a couple of
Speaking of barbecuing, and not at all what Max had perfectly set up for a segue, the PlayStation Plus lineup has partially been revealed, which is sort of our big thing to talk about.
We're back, baby.
Yeah, we've been talking about PlayStation Plus a lot on the show, Jade. I know you, me and Mark have been talking a lot about like waiting for these things. We've been kind of joking about, will they do a blog post? Will they do a state of play? Will they do something else? They're doing blog posts. So obviously the service itself is launching in Asia in a week. I think it's launching next week and then in mid-June in the US and various other territories in June. But so we finally got a piece of the lineup. This is not the full 700 games, which I saw some people upset about. I also do think it's worth noting that as this is not the full list, we're going to get a lot more games. But essentially, just to do the big highlights, there will still be the monthly games if you're at the base PlayStation Plus level. Those like refresh first Tuesday of every month is still going to happen. But if you're on extra or premium slash deluxe being the version that doesn't have PS3 streaming in some territories, because that's the reality of the world, those games were starting to be revealed here. I'm going to start with PS4 and PS5 games. I'm not going to read every single one, but we learned a big chunk of the PlayStation Studios first party stuff for PS4 and PS5. A surprising amount of, I would say, Housemarque and Bluepoint. Basically everything their newest studios did are part of this.
Can I announce that they bought Bluepoint yet or no?
Yes, they did. Yeah, okay. That was it. Yeah.
Can I make a request?
Instead of you listing the names, can you act them out for us to guess?
Every single one of those.
A very long list.
This will be great. Yeah, for the audio listeners, they're going to love this. Bloodborne, I just make myself bleed a little bit, I guess. Yeah, okay. this is right off the bat.
I would have guessed whatever you're doing.
It's like, Brian, why are you stabbing Jonathon?
It's my one claw.
But yeah, so we got a bunch of those games for the PS4 and PS5 list. It's worth mentioning stuff like Infamous First Light and Second Son will be on there. Hits you may not have played, but games I love, like both Gravity Rushes will be on there. If you haven't played those, please play Gravity Rush. It's great. Stuff like the Shadow of the Colossus remake from Japan Studio / Bluepoint will be there as well. The Last of Us Remastered and The Last of Us Left Behind, but not The Last of Us Part 2. We can talk about that in a little bit. Uncharted The Nathan Drake Collection, Uncharted 4, and Uncharted The Lost Legacy, but not the Uncharted Legacy of Thieves Collection. So you don't get the PS5 upgrade via this one, which is a weird thing.
So that's one of my annoyances with this, is like a lot of these are PS4 versions.
Yeah.
So you can keep going.
Yeah, it's a weird one. So we knew that some of them were going to be there, but at least we do get stuff like, you get Spider-Man Miles Morales on PS5, but you don't get the Spider-Man remaster for PS5. You only get the PS4 version, which is a weird one. You do get Demon's Souls for PS5. You get Destruction All-Stars as well. You get the Ghost of Tsushima Director's Cut, which is obviously the full deluxe version. You do get the PS4 or PS5 version of that, depending on which console you have.
Demon's Souls is awesome, by the way.
Yeah. There's a ton of first parties we could get into, but then on the third party side for PS4, right now the biggest ones seem to be WB and Capcom are really involved here. So from like WB, you get stuff like Mortal Kombat 11, some other stuff further down there as well. Ubisoft is also, Batman Arkham Knight. Ubisoft is really big here because of Ubisoft Plus Classics, which is like a perk of the service you now get, but it's basically just part of the lineup. So stuff like Far Cry 4, Far Cry 3 Remaster, Assassin's Creed Valhalla will also be part of of it. Red Dead 2 is on here, and then really cool indies like Celeste, Dead Cells, Hollow Knight, and a few others.
This I like this stuff because it's like, for me, it's like when they put a bunch of EA stuff on Game Pass. Mm-hmm. It was like, I never would have gone to EA.com and paid them money for their library. But when it shows up to something I'm already subscribed to, awesome. Like the Ubisoft stuff, I'm not going to go play Ubisoft Plus games on whatever that is.
Yeah.
But if it just shows up in my PlayStation Plus premium extra adamantium tier, then I'm in.
I'm the same way. Like the only time I've ever spent money on EA Play is when I'm playing Apex. And when you're buying, currency for microtransaction Apex, you get a 10% discount. So like if I'm dropping $50 to buy a bunch of cosmetics and stuff 1 month, I'm like, might as well drop the $5 and get a month of exclusive or EA stat access and get the same value for the same price. So
that's exactly when it makes sense.
Yeah.
Well, also in a good sign, we are getting stuff as recent as Guardians of the Galaxy, which came out last fall.
Which
is great. And I think a good sign that we aren't going to, I think a lot of people were worried that we're not going to get too recent stuff. I think that's a sign that we're at least getting stuff within the last, six, 7 months.
Well, because they keep coming out and being like, new games, we'd go broke. What are you, crazy?
Yeah, exactly.
So it's cool when new games do make their way on there.
Yeah, exactly. But I do think something like not seeing the Legacy of Thieves collection, because that's just an upgrade. But because that came out this January, we're not seeing that on there. So I think that sort of, at minimum, I would say we're not going to see stuff from Sony that's at least not 8 months old.
Like, and you won't get stuff like Ragnarok Day and Date either.
Yeah, but third party wise, I do think we will see some stuff debut. I think we'll see more recent stuff come on here as well. But I did want to talk about these lists together. I know you all have like seen the blog posts and the tweets and everything, to get your initial reactions, because this list, not including the older stuff, this is what people are going to get on the two tiers, both extra and the deluxe premium. So this is, to me, this is what I think people are looking for when they're like, what's the Game Pass competitor? It's this. It's this library. It's these offerings. And at least for me, on like the first party side, knowing that we are not getting day and date stuff, I do think this is a pretty good first salvo. It's not the full library, of course, but in terms of this being an offering, if you're just getting a PS5 this summer, this fall, this is a pretty good lineup to be able to subscribe to and get all these games for one quick price.
Yeah. And it's also, this is like you implied, this is a moving target. Like nobody, or at least I can't, maybe you can, tell you what the launch lineup for Game Pass was, because it's evolved and changed so often that it's more about like, what are they adding, what are they taking away, what, like for me, it's I hop into those platforms and I just browse until I find something that's kind of interesting or cool or suits whatever mood I'm into that day, and I download it and I play it for a while, and maybe I finish it, maybe I don't. Like that's what this is about for me. So I'm glad that this is the direction they're going to.
So weird question, what does this mean for the, there's that PlayStation Plus collection of Sony classics that's on PS5, which I am a jaded, spoiled little pig boy, and I forgot that that's not standard issue across like PS4 and PS5.
Yeah.
But like that's, I mean, PS4, PlayStation Plus subscribers suddenly getting Bloodborne for free. That's cool.
Yeah.
So but like I've assumed that was standard issue because I, got the funny shaped console.
That collection will still be available, I believe, for base subscribers still.
Okay. That's cool.
They said that wasn't going away. They have taken like Persona 5 came off of that list. So they can
added anything, it,
but
no, right?
Yeah, they haven't really added. There was like pre-launch, they added like 3 games for it. But yeah, basically that list you'll still get.
Cool.
But these are, this is mid-tier, which I think right now looks to me like the best value until they show more of the classics collection. But Jada, what do you feel about this list?
I mean, I think it's a great start. We've got they announced about 100 titles out of the 740 that we're supposed to get. So this is like such a small taste, and they just kind of wanted to get the big names, the most well-known names, to get people to like, oh, this looks really cool, to get ready for the showcase where they're going to show off more of the bigger stuff and announce the full list. So I think it's a good start. Like Brian said, like, who knows? Like, there's very few people out there who probably remember what Game Pass looked like at its start, but it was not as, encompassing as it is now. It's like Game Pass is a lot better now. And that's because it's had time to grow. They added EA Access after a year or something, I think.
That's right.
A year for them to add that. So I'm glad that Sony is at least paying attention and we're getting the Ubisoft Plus right at the start for it. They're not going to take a year to add it to their service.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, it's a subscription, not a one-time membership. It's interesting to look at it like it is a service. It's going to continue. And I totally forgot. Like, what? I don't think Game Pass, had much to write home about when it first launched, or if it, it had did,
the
it was,
Halos and Gears of War,
yeah.
And that was, and like the rare collections and stuff like that,
right? And it was like, I feel like if you were, you know, an Xbox diehard, you kind of already had that stuff, and if you weren't, that wasn't enough to kind of lure you in. And it's sort of gradually every E3 they'd come out and they just show a bunch of trailers that said Game Pass in the corner, and hope Sony takes some cues from that and follows suit. But yeah, it's I mean, obviously I think we're too close to this to really like treat this like a beta, you know.
This is
the pricing structure, dumb as hell, really just confusing. I don't like it. I don't know what's going on. I'm gonna have to read more closely to figure out what's happening, but you know, this is, and again, what Brian said, like browsing is the appeal here. Like if you're looking at this as a list and being like, well, I don't know if this is gonna sell me, it's like, well, you're doing it wrong, you know. Give it a minute, give it a few months, you know.
But I mean, totally to what all of you are saying, I do think it, you know, especially being too close to it to a certain extent, this like this part of the service I think is really great for people who weren't able to buy every first party game, weren't around for the PS4. Maybe they did have an Xbox One, or maybe they just didn't have a PlayStation and skipped it but wanted to get on with PS5 or whatnot and have been lucky enough to get a console. Like if you day one look at this list and were like, okay, go play Ghost of Tsushima, go play The Last of Us, go play all the Uncharted, go play Bloodborne and Concrete Genie and Spider-Man and Death Stranding and Returnal and Demon Souls, like that is a really great thing to have in one go for someone who didn't play those games yet.
I mean, even if you're like, if you're not getting somebody to buy a PlayStation, if they borrow their friends and you know get a 1 month subscription and just tear through a bunch of these, that might be enough to convince them to grab one in the future. And that's pretty cool. Like that's kind of an awesome little welcome aboard type of thing.
And of course, sorry.
No, go ahead.
I was just going to say, already announced stuff like God of War, Horizon will be in there as well, the Zero Dawn. But so this is just like, if you missed out on PlayStation or maybe only played a few of these games, subscribe for like 3-4 months and you will have so many amazing games from day one to be able to jump into. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I know I've seen a lot of like people pointing out, it's like, well, I've already played all these games. Like PlayStation people, we already buy these games. We buy the Ghost of Tsushima, we buy Spider-Man. So like, what is this service adding for me? And it's like Max was saying, like, you're not really looking at it, right? You're not getting the service for like those 1 to 10 games that are like Sony exclusives. You're getting it for the selection and the browsing, like Brian said. Like, we really want to be able to just kind of peruse and play. Like, I know when I do my Game Pass like perusing, I go in, I find like maybe 4 or 5 games. I'm like, oh, this looks really cool. I heard about this. I saw a video. I want to play this. Download those all. I may not even play them right then and there. A lot of the times I don't end up playing them until I see the messaging of, hey, this game is leaving Game Pass in 2 weeks. I'm like, I better go play this right now. So, and that's how I kind of use these subscription services.
There's been like a big discussion forever in the video games industry, but I feel like it's ramped up specifically over the last 6-7 years because money's gotten tighter for everybody. Things have gotten more expensive. Mm-hmm. About this sort of like quantifying your dollar to fun hours to completion value ratio, right? And I feel like stuff like this removes that concern, because now you're only just really playing with time. And so there's a probably, like, if you're a PlayStation diehard, which you are because you're listening to the show, or like everyone here on the show, we've crushed through all the first party games, right? So when I see those on here, I'm like, cool, on behalf of the people who haven't played them, great. But for me, like, there's a bunch of weird third party games and indie games or AA games that aren't as well known, that maybe I didn't want to spend $10, $15, $20 on. Like, you know, I'm not traveling as much anymore, so I'm less inclined to buy a bunch of indies on Switch before like a 7-hour flight. So now I'm playing most of those on my TV. And so this is the place to get stuff like that. Like, this is where these places are going to come into the conversation. Cause like we were talking about Unpacking before, that's a game I don't know if I would have paid for, but I played it through Game Pass and I adored it.
Yep.
And it took me a few hours and it didn't break the bank. And I was like, I really enjoyed that. I'm really glad I got to do that. On to the next thing.
Yeah.
And so that's for you listening at home, like that's where this library will shine for you eventually. And so I implore you to kind of like dig in, look up reviews for some of the lesser known,
also
kind of interesting games.
This is the tip of the iceberg. This is not all 700,000 or however it is. Like it's not 1,000, but
7 million. $1 billion.
Like, obviously, like if we're kind of zeroed in on the stuff, and if, you know, like this is all like the greatest hits. This is all like the big name stuff that people are going to recognize and it's going to get their attention. But for like the weird, deeper cut, smaller indie things, that's obviously going to be kind of lower on the list. And that's, I mean, when they're advertising, like, I don't know, Netflix, they're not like, great news, the 1997 Val Kilmer film, The Saint, is on there. Like, but I'm going to turn that on and be like, oh, I want to want to play that. I love that when I was 10. And there's going to be something that pops up and they're like, you know, older PS4 games or some, you know, some forgotten thing. And I'll be like, I'm going to play this again. I'm, you know, check this out. I never played it.
Well, and even with like all your points about sort of the indies and the deeper cuts, even with this initial list, it's like, did you play Ashen and Outer Wilds and Celeste and Hollow Knight and Dead Cells and The Artful Escape? You all did.
Yes, I did.
But probably not necessarily everyone.
Ashen is super cool though. That's Ashen's exactly great. Like, you know, like if you're like, oh, I beat Elden Ring and I played a bunch of Souls games and I want something sort of adjacent to that.
Have you ever played Dark Souls and wished that the textures didn't load? Well,
I think they also have their next game Flintlock coming out this year, which looks really cool. Those devs. I totally agree with all of you. This is just the beginning of it, and so who knows what we're going to get. And then, of course, the big question is, what third parties do we get day and date, or indies, and when, or like how soon after launch? Because I think that's what's going to matter to people, and they obviously aren't going to announce like, oh, an indie coming out 6 months from now is going to be on the service. They just like can't do that via this way. But that'll be, I think, where people make or break and stay subscribe to this, or if they decide to bounce off, if there is a continued interesting update. And there will be, they said, mid-month, there will be updates every month. They didn't say how many games or the variety of games, excuse me, but there will be those updates monthly.
Yeah.
Great.
So, and higher tiers getting, I love the fact that the higher tiers are getting that second refresh in the middle of the month. That's great. That gives you extra value for that extra money you're spending. And then also the fact that they touched on, and I'm sure you're about to get to it, but the previous purchases for PSP, PS1, original titles, those will be available to download at no charge if you purchase those.
It's incredible.
Frankly, shocking.
Yeah,
to 100%. Me, but super cool.
Before we get into that, because I do think it's worth shouting out, I do just want to read that actual info. So, of course, this relates to the premium/deluxe tiers, the highest tier. This is where we get the classic games catalog. And as Jada mentioned, one of the big things that they mention here is this is straight from the PlayStation blog. Players who have previously purchased the digital versions of select games from the original PlayStation and PSP generation will not have to make a separate purchase or sign up for PlayStation Plus to play these titles on PS4 or PS5. When they're released, players can head to the PlayStation Store and download a version for the consoles at no extra cost if they already own the digital version of the title. And some titles will also just be available for individual purchase.
Right.
Additionally, some remastered classics from previous console generations will be added to PlayStation Plus, and they give us a list. Another thing that's also worth pointing out for these classic games, original PlayStation and PSP, members will also enjoy a new user interface with the menus that allows you to save your game at any time or rewind the game if you want to do over. So essentially what the classic like mini systems for PlayStation Nintendo did. So those will be there for older gens. But to just mention some of the things, it's a very small and eclectic list right now, and I think this is the biggest gap that we need to discuss. But from PlayStation for PS1 and PSP, Ape Escape, Hot Shots Golf, IQ Intelligent Cube, Jumping Flash, Siphon Filter, and Super Stardust Portable.
Jumping Flash, great.
So only one PSP game from first party has been announced so far, and then from third parties, Mr. Driller, Tekken 2, Worms World Party, and Worms Armageddon are the original PlayStation and PSP games. Then you get into PS2, which is a weird one where they're mostly just showing right now games that have been remastered. So if a PS2 game was remastered for PS4, like Ape Escape 2, the Dark Cloud games, the Jack games, Siren, a few others, even stuff like Bioshock Remastered and Borderlands and Bulletstorm are listed here, you're getting the PS4 remastered version of those games, but they're part of the classics library, which is a weird sort of like, they're PS2 games, but you're getting the PS4 version, but they don't count in the PS4 library, I think. It's weird. So that's part of it. And then, of course, PS3 games via streaming. And right now, this seems to be largely stuff you would expect from PS Now. So the original Infamous games, a few of the Ratchet and Clank games from PS3, not Tools of Destruction. That's the one. You do also get Tokyo Jungle is on there.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
That is a cool, weird little game. Yeah. I haven't played that in 10 years, so I don't remember exactly what it's like. But I remember it being not necessarily like a Souls-like, but very kind of roguelike-y and hard as hell.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I feel like when that came out, that wasn't really a thing that people were so vocal about wanting.
Yeah.
Like, obviously, there was a small, you know, crowd that was like, this game rules. But that's definitely a game I've been wanting to go back and try, kind of like now having kind of digested that approach to games.
The classic games that you purchase returning from the grave is like super interesting to me, because like there's a bunch of stuff in there that I probably bought that I don't remember buying, and I don't think there was like a way of really checking that. recently.
Unless you went on your PS3 or Vita.
Yeah. Which I haven't looked at in a very long time. But yeah, I mean, credit where credit's due. They are starting to bring classic games to PS5. And we spent quite a long time when they first announced they were delisting the stores on their legacy consoles, complaining on the show about how it's important and integral to their future to respect and, you know, revisit and maintain a relationship with their classic game lineup. And this is not a lot, but it's a good start.
There are more coming.
Yeah.
I'm happy about that. I hope that a good chunk of them are like old, you know, old school stuff like that.
Me too.
That's fun.
Me too.
Yeah. It's a solid initial lineup. And I think them saying that was such a relief. I to set expectations. I don't think you should suddenly expect every classic game you own to be available on your PS4 or PS5. I don't think we're going to get that maybe ever, but at least definitely not day one. But just the fact that they're doing it, like you said, was surprising and unexpected.
Well, they also, a good thing. They'll get to do that thing that Nintendo does drunkenly on a Tuesday once a month where they're like, hey, you guys remember Kirby and the Secret Shards? Well, coming back on Thursday. And you're like, that's your announcement? Or they'll just show you one NES game that you never played.
Yep.
It's like an Australian upside down puzzle game. And they're like, it's showing up on Friday.
Mr. Dribble's Divorce is coming to the Nintendo Switch. Okay. It's weird, but they'll be able to do that. And that's the thing that like we've talked about a lot on the show for years is like, I think people sometimes get frustrated by how quiet PlayStation can be. This being a monthly second drop that they have to focus on just naturally facilitates them being in the conversation
more. Yeah.
Which is the thing people were like, oh, well, there's a new Game Pass game revealed every day. And I know people like get frustrated when we talk about it, but that's sort of the you know, online perspective is like, you see those things every week. You don't see the PlayStation thing. This is another drop we're going to get monthly. It does go back to older generations, which will manage a lot of people. Mm-hmm. I think this is a cool initial showing.
Take that conversation back, you know, like, I mean, like I do think I've said this before, Twitter's not real life. It's a fake worse version of the bad version we have already somehow.
Yeah.
But like, you know, when Xbox or Nintendo is just like, here's this cool game that we're putting out in this day. I think people gravitate towards that and it becomes a conversation, and Sony has like a fantastic opportunity here to take a big chunk of that conversation. So
so much of generations are decided by word of mouth, and, you know, like telling your friends, and then like, and now like back in the day, that's what we had. We had to just go tell our friends and share our stories with each other. But now that Twitter's there, like all the other companies we've seen kind of have, they're like, they adapted to that new strategy and they have been dominating word of mouth on online.
Yeah.
So, like it's very important.
It's going to attract new subscribers regularly. It's going to keep old subscribers from bailing on their subscription unless it auto renews, which mine always has. But like, I'll say like their offerings right now in terms of PlayStation Plus once a month being like, here's three or four games is like pretty paltry. And it's like, it always makes me go like, I have that. Don't need that. Don't even care about what that is. See you next month. You know? So this will fix that.
It's a potential exciting recurring thing that we'll have to discuss on the show and to discuss as PlayStation fans. And another part of it that I'm curious to see how it'll unfold is just to mention, we've talked about on the show before, but the time-limited game trials will be happening. We had some reports that apparently every game above essentially $35 will be getting these. PlayStation doesn't imply that here and sort of like it's going to be widespread. We only got six games confirmed, and these are previously revealed games. And obviously the report said that older games wouldn't be held to this, but if you are a subscriber on the premium plan, you will get at least 2-hour game trials for the Legacy of Thieves collection, Horizon Forbidden West, Cyberpunk 2077, Farming Simulator 22, Tiny Tina's Wonderlands, and WWE 2K22.
Wait, hold on. So as a subscriber, you get access to the Nathan Drake Uncharted Collection Trilogy, whatever the PS4 version is called. But if you're really curious about the PS5 version, you can play the first two hours of it to see if you need that extra hair textures or whatever. Okay.
So but that's your progress carries over and your trophies carry over.
Yes.
I remember reading it this morning, actually.
If you purchase the game, you'll get all that stuff carried over, which is great. And you know, this is a thing that I think we've talked about a lot on the show of like loving demos, loving letting people get a sense of if they want to play a game. And especially after seeing what happened with Cyberpunk, a trial like this probably would have changed a lot of minds at the time. It is just the PS5 version. It's worth noting, though. They don't want people testing out the PS4 version. So
Cyberpunk?
Cyberpunk, yeah.
I regularly forget that that's a thing that exists.
Yeah,
but,
yeah.
And so did CD Projekt Red.
Yeah, I think because you literally couldn't buy it for like a year.
Yeah, so, you know, so, some limitations there. We'll see how often these get applied to games. But again, it's another good perk. This is only on that top tier of the premium deluxe version.
I think that's garbage.
I think it should be lower.
Like, this could be like, I don't know, offset by like marketing money. It's a demo, you know, come on. Like, I feel like it's not 1996. We shouldn't be paying money for a paper magazine with a demo disc. Like, they can just... you know, shoot it's, that
this
out
is like either. When they give like free gift bags to celebrities, you're like, they already have that.
Yeah,
they're fine.
This is very much not, as we've heard from reports, it's not like the devs are making a slice of the game or are making a bespoke demo. These are things that essentially the PlayStation Store staff are creating a like timed gate for you to play the game. So it's not a thing that, as far as we know, will create more work for the devs. There are questions of whether devs have a say in how much of their game gets to be played for a trial, which obviously probably matters to some devs, especially if their game is 6 hours long.
I want to see speedrunners have some fun with this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, I don't think you could beat the Uncharted collection in 2 hours, but I want to see how far you can get. Like, I think that'd be really fun.
Honestly, a glitched run probably could get through at least the first two in 2 hours, I'd say.
Yeah. If Nathan Drake eats the crates instead of pushes them, he falls through the geometry and gets to the main boss. I wonder if you can shut off... like if you change the time settings or shut off your internet and like cheat. Maybe I said that too loud. Don't do anything illegal.
I mean, but let's be real. There's going to be exploits. People are going to find workarounds. Yeah. That's just technology now.
And I can't wait for it. It's going to be so much fun.
It's going to be great news stories for us to see like, oh, this person managed to do this.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, it's an interesting place that we're going to have to see go forward with all of this stuff. There are gaps that I would like everyone to talk about, but we're in a weird situation where due to timing, I have to leave.
Forever.
Oh.
Not forever.
Oh.
But I want y'all to continue talking.
Okay. I read that
about fun things and have a fun time with
someone. Should have brought a laptop. I have a phone.
Do you want my laptop?
No, I don't want your laptop.
You can. Your chair. I just noticed you have a different chair.
I do have a different chair.
It's the fancy chair. He's loved.
But I do actually have to leave for unrelated reasons to the show, which bums me out. But it's so wonderful to be here with you all.
Yeah.
To be able to talk about
stuff.
Like, whatever.
My HelloFresh box is on the way.
This is such an saying goodbye at a party.
I love that we're just back to how it used to be, where like one of us like, I gotta run, we got a meeting to go to. It's like, okay, well don't take the microphone with you. Like, exactly. It's just sort of awkward.
Do we have like a thing we can put in your chair to just pretend is you?
There might be a big plush outside. Maybe we can find
a bike
somewhere.
Pump over there for some reason.
Oh yeah, just put that
was a pogo stick.
Whatever would be interesting, but not surprising for me to find in the IGN.
In IGN,
and like, mind you, this is, you guys have been in IGN audiences for years, or audiences in studios for years. This is my first time in studio for any
production. Yeah,
because like, I literally just came up on my 1 year anniversary yesterday.
Right.
Congratulations.
So, welcome. Yeah.
That's what we should be celebrating. That rules.
Yeah.
We got you a pogo stick.
Yeah.
And I appreciate that. So I will definitely break both of my ankles later today.
Hop to it.
Yes.
Well, Jada, I deputize you to continue running this train. Make sure nothing goes crazy, but I hope you all have an amazing time.
We are totally going to get weird.
Perfect. Yeah. Go for it.
It's going to get so
weird. I'm excited to listen.
Get me an Xbox show.
Oh, no. I'm sure the comments will be happy with that.
Yes.
But no, this has genuinely been so wonderful. I hope we can do this again very soon. But yeah, thank you all.
And thank you, Jonathon.
Saying goodbye in the middle of the show, but you all out there are wonderful as well. And thank you for tuning in.
And this good luck. Wonderful. Parasailing today. I think
thank
it's beautiful
you.
That you're leaving early.
I'm just taking a break. Yeah, I'm just having fun times. But no, yeah, I leave you all to it.
You know what? I'm kind of honored. Like, this is my first time in studio, and I get to take over the rails of
hosting. Isn't that
great? It's like, it's kind of a dream come true. Like, I've listened to Beyond for years, and now I get to head
the ship. It's your 11th birthday. You get to drive the car home. You know?
Oh man, driving at 11. That was good times. Those were good times. But you know, so one of the things, segments that I've been doing that I would love to get your guys's kind of feeds into what we were talking about earlier. We were doing previous episodes. We did, you know, PS1 games, PS2 games, PSP games that we wanted to see on the list that before we got the list. Obviously, we've got the list now. Mm-hmm. What titles are you guys hoping that we get to see in the next drop?
Yeah.
Any Metal Gear, like, I mean, well, specifically 1 and 4, because those are locked onto PS1 and PS3 respectively. And, you know, we've gotten the HD collection ported to various things, and that's great. But, like, it's stupid that the only legal way you could play Metal Gear Solid 1 shy of buying it on a PS3 digitally was buying the PS1 Classic and playing it without the dual analog sticks.
So I was going to say the same games, but I believe they were on PlayStation Now and Konami pulled them off like just recently, which totally sucks. So yes, bring those back.
Okay. All right. Yeah.
I'm also just, I feel like I'm just so not there on streaming yet. Like with games, I just, it seems like half measure. Mm-hmm. Like I would so much rather, can somebody figure out how to use the infinite power of the PlayStation 5 to emulate a PS3, or is that just asking for too much? I don't know.
Yeah, like my biggest issue I have with like the streaming is I love to take captures of my games. I love to record videos of my awesome moments because I get the buggiest, glitchiest moments in all the games I play. I played Cyberpunk. I would walk off a couch and die. Like, literally, like, I would be standing on a couch, walk off, break my ankle, and then my neck. And I would flatline. And I was just like, how is this happening? Like, and obviously, Cyberpunk is a unique case, but
right.
I get this all the time. I was playing, like, Ghostwire Tokyo, and I got grabbed by one of the scary ladies with the scissors, and she threw me through the ground. And, like, I just watched as I fell into the... what's it called in Get Out? The
sunken place.
The sunken place. Yeah, it was basically like that. Watching as I went down.
You had that happen to you in Elden Ring.
Yeah, but that's actually, there's a wonderful silver lining to that, which people have been. Have you seen the Elden Ring glitching, like the cheesing that people do?
The warp glitch.
Basically, there's a bunch of spaces where if you jump off a cliff in the right spot, you'll just fall through the air, you know, infinitely. But when you attack, it resets the fall counter. Mm-hmm. So basically, you fall. You keep falling. You're like, you know, like Loki and Thor Ragnarok. You just keep falling. And what happens is if you're close enough to a certain area, it spawns enemies. It just assumes that you're sort of nearby. But the second you fall far enough away from them, it thinks that they're dead.
Mm.
So it kills them for you, basically. And you'll just be falling through this infinite void. And then it'll pop up and it'll be like, you got a shield. You got a shield. You got a rune. And then you'll get just like a crap load of runes out of nowhere. And you're like, all right. And then maybe you die. But you just get all this stuff because it like it spawned imaginary enemies and then killed them off for you.
If you die, where does your money bag show up?
I mean, it usually pops up on the last ledge that you were physically on. So yeah, you would just be able to go back to that.
Oh, because the game thought you died there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it always like rubber bands you back to that last safe point.
Mm-hmm.
Is what they kind of do with it. Even though many times our runes are not in safe places when we die.
No, that's amazing.
It's very cool. There's a bunch of videos on that online, and it's all like, I've tried to do some intentionally where like it's like jump off this exact spot next to this small branch and aim for the tree, but then double jump at this exact moment, and then you'll wind up in the perfect thing. I like died 7 times in a row, and I'm like, I can just fight the boss and do it the old fashioned way. And then I was just like rushing through like, you know, urn root caverns or whatever, and then like I just slipped, like I just wasn't seeing where I was going. Me and my horse just went off the edge, and I was like, and I just started spamming the attack, and it was just like, oh, I won. Like, I found
those are the best.
Yeah.
Those are the best moments. I've been playing with my partner, and I went through Lane Dell the proper way, got, you know, fought the tree sentinels and took the lift up and everything like that. And got into the city. He's been trying to go the back route where, you know, when you get teleported by that chest and you have to fight like that giant guardian that's there. Mm. But there's the elevator. You can't get up unless because the switch is at the bottom.
Right.
I showed him a video of where you can literally walk off that ledge. And if you have the flask with the explosion in it, if you time the drinking of your flask while walking off the ledge and attack, you can cause the explosion to cancel your fall timer. And so you can get down there without doing it. But it takes such perfect time. He spent probably an hour and didn't get it done. So I'm sorry, babe. But it was fun to watch.
That's the real like meta game, is when you find a thing that you just really want to try to do in a game, even though it's like completely pointless. It's just like, I mean, in that case, there's a point to it.
Yeah. But
I don't know. It feels like trying to land a jump in GTA or something, except you're trying to drink an explosive potion to avoid fall damage.
Yeah. It's like I do that. Like, I always have these points in these like tougher games where like at the start of the game, I find these kind of like roadblocks that aren't meant to be overcome at the start. So like with Elden Ring, there was like the tree sentinel. I did not move on until I beat that tree sentinel with no damage at level 7. Like, I literally just torched him.
You know how you beat that idiot? Is I actually started doing like a violence build or whatever, like a, you know, dex. And then I found out that you can cheese him by sneaking up around that horse's butthole and just blowing poison into it.
Oh.
And so I just went back there and I just like...
and just watched him.
For like 20 minutes. And then the horse just falls over and the dude dies. And you just poison him. You just poison him and wait. And then I'm like, maybe I'm a scumbag now. Maybe I'm playing a real piece of build, and I just have proceeded to go around being like, oh, you're bleeding. Oh, you're poison. Oh, you've got scarlet rot. Good job.
Be cheap
just,
and dirty. They are
I'm
too.
So cheap. It's great.
Everyone in that game is cheap and dirty. Be mm-hmm. cheap and dirty if you got to be.
100%. One of the games that I'm definitely looking forward to from our audience is Guitaru Man. I don't know if you guys have played that, but it's a really kind of weird rhythm game that was like Parappa Rappa and stuff like that back in the day. But they released it on, I believe, PS2 and then PSP. Mm-hmm. And then I told our audience I'd give a shout out to that. So there's your Guitaru Man shout out.
Hell yeah.
But yeah.
A friend of mine bought a hacked PS2 and had, you know, came with a bunch of ROMs on it, which I played so that I could accurately describe them to the police when I called them on him, because that's illegal. But Mr. Mosquito is such a weird game to go back to.
So weird.
It's also hard as hell,
mm-hmm.
but it's just bonkers that somebody was like, we're making a flight sim. Is it about jets? No, it's about a perverted mosquito who's trying to bite a woman in the thighs. Like, all right, go for it, PS2.
There's so many
go
weird
nuts.
Games. There was like Ribbit King where you play golf, but your golf balls were frogs. And so, like, you would
yes.
hit them, and then, like they would land, and then they would hop once. But if they hopped into the water, they would swim across the water. Or if they landed next to a fly, they would jump to the fly.
That's
and there
awesome.
Was just all types of different combos and stuff. So I'd love to see that one come back as well. But yeah, totally agree. Metal Gear, those mm-hmm. ones are
a totally deep
totally
cut thing that will not happen is Thrasher Skate and Destroy, which is Rockstar's answer to Tony Hawk, and it's
oh my god,
we talked about this. So it's got pretty, it's got like really good like old school licensed hip hop, which is why it will never come back because it has licensed music and that means it's doomed to
yep.
die in obscurity. Mm-hmm. I mostly played a demo of this, which was glitchy as hell. And occasionally you would like go up a half pipe and then you'd wind up in the sunken place just doing like infinite ollies through the space, which mm-hmm. I thought was really fun. And again, like, you know, like your partner trying to
yeah.
glitch an elevator, it becomes more fun than the actual game. But the thing in that game that was hilarious is like you would basically try to do a bunch of tricks in a time limit. And then when the time limit was up, the camera would shift to a first person perspective of a cop with a taser who was chasing after you. And so you'd have to skate away from the cop and he'd be like, hey, get back here. Hey, no skating, you punk kids. Skateboarding is a crime. And then eventually he'd be like, oh, I'm having a heart attack and like fall over. It's like, oh, let's go get some donuts or something. It was like such like it was such like a stupid like. Teenagers drawing in a notebook of a game. So I don't know, that would be a fun one.
That's so bizarre. I do not remember that game at all, so thank you.
It's not a well-known one, I don't think.
It's one of those like weird Dark Ages Rockstar games.
Yeah,
gotta love those times. Gotta mm-hmm. love those times. So a couple other, you know, news beats or whatnot we'll kind of touch on real shortly. We saw Insomniac's donating $50,000 to abortion rights following the Jim Ryan controversy of him, you know, getting his foot stuck in his mouth. I'm super supportive of Insomniac. I'm very happy that they are
yeah.
standing up for their rights and their employees, just as Bungie when they made their statement. It's really good to see that these studios are putting their employees first and their audience first, to be honest. Like mm-hmm. there's so many people that like,
and the year,
right? Mm-hmm. Yeah,
it's, which is cool. The year that is this year and not
yeah. If
the
you
year
like,
from 50,
if you
60
like,
years
you know,
ago.
Draconian, old fashioned, you know, ridiculous, misogynistic laws. Why not just make a fantasy RPG?
Yeah,
just go do that.
Instead of video games, you could check out caves. They've
yeah.
been around for a very
illuminated
long time.
Illuminated manuscripts.
Yeah, there's maybe you'll find a dragon or
sifting and, lead from drinking water.
Right, and if someone, you know, if you don't like someone, maybe if they sink or float, we can find out if they're a witch. There's a lot of stuff you can do instead of playing the new Spider-Man game for PS5 if you're not a fan of this.
Anyway,
that said, I do wish it was more money.
I agree. Yeah, there it's a drop in the bucket. Mm-hmm. I really hope Sony kind of like changes course and matches that plus more.
Yeah.
So, but
like, I think Peter Parker would donate more money and he's in high school.
So we've got some rumors on Silent Hill. Apparently it's confirmed by an absence of comfort, but all but an absence of confirmation from an interview that we did. Mm-hmm. Silent Hill fans?
Yeah, I mean, I like the idea of it. I never got into it as a kid because I was mm-hmm. a huge coward. But like, I'm also like, I don't know, it's got sick art direction. And
yeah,
this is hilarious because it's the CEO of Team Bloober who I feel like they keep having either leaks or rumors or whatever. And then they keep asking him. And then instead of just like ninja vanish smoke bombing out of the situation, he says something that is like a no comment, but really sort of seems to confirm what's being
yes.
said, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's just, it seems like Team Bloober is working with Konami on a game and Team Bloober is also working on a new IP and then a blah, 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 something. And people are like, wait, so with Konami? with like a, and it's not a new IP.
Yeah.
And he's like, we're not ready to talk about that yet. And it's like, well, it's probably Silent Hill, you
yeah.
know?
Yeah, no, my
Pro Evolution survival horror or whatever.
My anticipation for whatever all of this is at its peak, and then like my patience is at its rock bottom. Like that's where we are with this, because it's sort of like, if you know, like, as you all know, we're like, where this franchise was last left, it was playable trailer, you know, PT, which got delisted, and you can't like legally get that on a system if you deleted it or whatever. There's ways to play it and download it. Obviously, people, you know, fans have preserved it.
They've like remade it in Dreams, which is apparently easier than actually just playing it, you know?
Which was supposed to become a game that then got canceled. Kojima left, went to do his own thing. That franchise has been in limbo. Then there's like that abandoned team came out, and they were just like, we're going to be pretend Silent Hill. And we're like, you're a bunch of grifters and liars. So that happened. And now there's like, there's all these rumors. It's like, okay, so like a small team might be working on a new Silent Hill. There might be like the Blue River version, which we don't know is a remake of Silent Hill 2 or not. And there's just like a lot swirling around, and I just want answers at this point. I just want to know where this franchise is. Like I got a Steam Deck recently, and I was like, oh cool, so this, I'll be able to play a bunch of old random garbage on here, right? Silent Hill, the only one on there is Homecoming, and then all the content they put into Dead by Daylight, which is like not enough.
To be fair, Homecoming is the only one that I did play, because I was also a chicken chick growing up, and I just did not.
Is that the one where you asked Pyramid Head to the dance?
I think maybe I didn't get that ending.
I wish.
there's so many endings in Silent Hill games, and that's the one thing I do love, and I would love to get to revisit those. So hopefully maybe we'll get those on the PS Premium as well. Like that would be, I feel like that's a kind of a layup for PlayStation to get those on the service.
Yeah, I hope we find out something about that franchise soon.
Like, yeah,
I
think that's where everybody's at.
I'm a huge horror fan. I'm a huge horror video game fan. I just want something soon, because I like the speculation part. We're at the point where I'm just like, that's enough. We've heard of this enough speculation.
We can only take so much speculation.
There's only like rumors and speculation that we can take before it's just like, just let the air out, you know? Like,
yep. Before we're ready to move on to some new team that's building something unique.
Exactly.
And like that's where we want to put our attention now.
Exactly. And I wasn't the biggest fan of the Medium or Blair Witch game, but I think that there's like,
I think they did some really cool things in them, but yeah, but I feel like the overall execution was just kind of a little miss off the mark.
They're like spot on 6.57 out of 10 games to me. And
they're like horror movies.
Yeah.
They're, you know, it's, they are spooky, but maybe they could use work, whatever. But I mean, obviously we've kind of watched that studio scale up a bit, and like the Medium was certainly ambitious for, you know, what it was doing. And it was also trying really, like, wasn't that was the Silent Hill composer, right?
I believe so.
Sounds right.
Yeah. And it's just, I don't know. It seems like they're kind of auditioning to do a Silent Hill game. And that would be cool. There's also the Silent Hill creators new studio, which is they're doing. Oh, we've saw that. That got revealed. It's the
Scorn.
No. It's the one where the people, their mouths open real wide. It looks kind of Tokyo Ghostwire in that it's ghosts in Tokyo, but it's got people. Slitterhead.
Slitterhead.
Yeah.
We weren't that far. You weren't that far off.
No. It got shown off at it's the Bokeh Game Studio. And yeah, we saw this. It got shown off. I don't know where. It's with the Gravity Rush devs.
Okay.
And it got shown off at the Game Awards.
All right.
It looks completely bonkers. And we're all like, this looks cool. And then we forgot because we went and opened Christmas presents or whatever it is you do after the Game Awards. I don't know. Yeah, that looks wild. And it's also like clearly kind of a very different tone from what we think of when we think of Silent Hill. But again, what does that mean?
Yeah.
25 years later.
Could mean anything at this point. Yeah. So outside of, on a more happier note, we've got Fall Guys is going to free to play on June 21st.
Very cool.
And it's going to be cross play and cross progression. So if you want to play on your Xbox with your Xbox friends, or with your PlayStation with your PlayStation friends, or mix and match it up, because that's what households are most of the time. People have it, or Switch, or on the Epic Game Store on PC, because it's getting pulled off of Steam because Epic bought Fall Guys. So they now own that. So they joined the Fortnite and Rock Band and all the Harmonix and all of them that are over at Epic now. Are you guys still playing Fall Guys?
No.
Every night before bed. I get my chamomile tea and I go in there and I do those falls.
I played it so like regularly the first like two or three seasons. I think we're on season six now. But now I kind of get my endorphin rush from just going on Twitter and looking at Shuhei Yoshida's Twitter, because he's playing it regularly and he wins. He went, like, he posts his wins on Twitter. So I get my endorphin rush from Fall Guys just watching Shuhei go out there and just dominate on other players. And it's
great. I will say when popular IPs join the game and become like bizarre, squat, super deformed versions of themselves, I appreciate that aesthetic about a billion times more than like, say, a Funko Pop.
Yep.
So when I saw like the Ghost of Tsushima one, that skin, and I was just like, that's adorable. Like there's something really lovely about that style that like translates super well. Mm-hmm. And it's one of those things where it's like, I don't play it. I appreciate the hell out of it. It is so earnest and just sweet and also just aggressively goofy that I can't help but respect the hell out of what they're doing over there.
No, I think we checked that out at E3 at the Devolver booth a million years ago, and it was like, this is really cool. And it also seemed crazy ambitious for an indie game to be making a battle royale that needs like 100 people to play it, let alone one that's completely wackadoo. And then it totally blew up, which I'm so happy for. And like, I mean, I had a really good time with it first when it first came out. I haven't gone back and checked it out, but like, again, it's like, I'm so happy it exists. I'm glad that Epic scooped it up. I think that they need to add more pratfalls and scrambles to Fortnite. I think there needs to be more bumbling and tumbling and rolling down the big foam hills.
Jay, did you play Fortnite?
I do not.
Because you're like super into like a bunch of online games, right?
I play like a lot of stuff, but Apex has ruined me from pretty much every battle royale minus Fall Guys because it's just not a shooter. Apex has kind of ruined me for like all shooters. Like the movement is just so fast and smooth, and like I can't swap to other games that feel everything else feels slower for
me. I think it was last year you posted up your PlayStation stats.
Yes.
And Apex was in there.
Yeah, it was like, just like, it was like 1800 hours or 2100 hours or something like that in Apex. Like, yeah, I play.
Well done.
It's my daily go-to. Like sometimes I'll wake up in the morning and I will like to wake my brain up. I'm like, all right, let's go play Apex. And it's a terrible idea, you'd think. But like minus today, because I had to get up early to come in the studio, I won my first game. I played each morning and like rolled into our morning meeting. I'm like, yeah, I got that W. Let's go. This day's ready to start. So nice. I love Apex. I love it. I love the new season is out. It's such a great game. I need a squad though. I need people. You guys got to come and play with me. I'll carry you guys.
Like this, it's hard to get us to do anything, right? We haven't been on the show in like
if you want to carry something, go buy groceries. Like, I don't know. No, I played a bit of that when it first came out. My issue with battle royale shooters, I guess, or battle royales in general, is that like I suck, and so like if I'm out early, I'm like, well, I could have done other things, you know. Like typically, you don't get to respawn. I guess Warzone is kind of forgiving in that sense if you got a squad or whatever. But like as far as I typically just wind up getting wiped, and then it's like, and even if I do stick around, if I do hang in there, it's like a long chunk of time for a full match. So like I got really into Call of Duty Cold Wars. Just basic, you know, basic vanilla multiplayer of just doing like deathmatch and stuff. Cause it's like, do I have 10 minutes? Okay, I'll play a match, you know, and I know how long I'm in for.
Yeah, no, I definitely totally understand that. Thankfully, like, Apex has added new modes and stuff like that. They added like a control mode, which is 99, and that gives you infinite respawns and stuff.
That's
like
cool.
That.
Yeah.
It's a limited time mode, so it's not always there, but definitely something to check out for if you're wanting to kind of go back and see what's new. It's a good time to do that. Last kind of note we've got is Sega is planning a bunch of remakes and remasters. Obviously, we know there's the Sonic Origins collection, if I remember correctly, which is Sonic 1, 2, 3, and CD. But they also talked that they've got like 10 others that are in the works for the next like 1 to 2 fiscal years. What are you guys thinking Sega's got cooking?
Well, I can tell you what I want, and it's like hyper specific, but they made a game called Pinball of the Dead, which was basically House of the Dead Pinball. I love all the House of the Dead games. I'm pretty bummed that the new one is like apparently not great. And
the remaster.
But I would also really love a remake of House of the Dead Overkill, which was the one they put on Switch, which was...
Was that Switch or was that Wii?
No, Wii. I'm sorry. Yes. Yeah. Yes. Very old.
No, I'm right there with you.
And it was incredibly, like, aggressively grindhouse and very just gritty and grimy and just full of just naughty words. And it was just fun, like, goofy game you could play with, like, your friend in, like, 45 minutes, 30 minutes, crush through the whole game, and then you go do alternate paths and stuff like that. So I would love for that to make a return. Light-gun stuff's weird now because it's like there isn't like a great way to do that. But like if they figured out a way to like, because TVs are different basically.
You know what'd be cool as hell is if they did a way to emulate that in VR.
Yeah.
Because if you've got the hands to do the light, you virtual light gun, virtual cabinet, just stand in front of it. Yeah, right.
That would be really cool.
That also seems like a thing that I don't know how many. I don't know how many light guns Sega has. Do they have a lot of those, or is it
was Time Crisis Sega as well? I can't remember if Time Crisis.
I think that's Bandai or Tecmo.
Yeah, that might
it might be.
Yeah.
But somebody's gonna jump on that because it's like, I mean, that's a smart use of that. You don't have to buy any peripherals. You don't have to make any plastic stuff to take up shelf space. And
to
like
license people.
I mean,
know.
Sega had that Genesis collection where you were in like a rendered child's bedroom, you know, and then you went over and messed around with the Sega games, which is a really, I think it's a really cool way of packaging that kind of stuff. Even if you don't actually touch the original game, it's just sort of like, I think the Pac-Man Museum is doing a similar thing where it's just like basically Animal Crossing Pac-Man, but then to earn money, you play Pac-Man, which is a cool idea.
I love when they make like this sort of like curated setting for it. And it's not just like a list. I also think that they just did Monkey Ball 1 and 2 recently, which are like, that's two of my favorite Sega games ever. But I think they should do Big Billy Hatcher and his big ass.
That would be great. I would love to see Billy Hatcher come back. I think for me, I'm looking forward to Vanquish. I really loved Vanquish.
I was going
to
say, like, I never messed with that, but that's
such
is
a
that
good game.
Mikami, or is that, who did that?
I think it might have been Platinum with Sega Publishing, if I remember correctly. Because they bundled it with Bayonetta on the PS store.
Right, so it makes
sense if it's both on the same game, card company. But I really love Vanquish. That was just so cool being able to slide around the battlefield. I think that's what kind of like got me. That's really what, why Apex really sticks with me, because I love just being able to slide around and shoot people in the kneecaps. It's just great. And then, you know, I'd love to see Bayonetta 2 come to the other consoles because it's Switch only right now, right?
Yeah, I would be amazed if that happened, because I think Nintendo kind of paid money to bring that one to the finish line.
Yeah.
But I mean, never say never. Like most of our adult lives have been spent watching games that we once thought were exclusive. You mentioned Mikami before, who once offered to cut off his own head if Resident Evil 4 came to any other platform, and it came to every other platform.
Yes.
Literally everyone.
Nice.
I'm trying to think of Sega games that I'd want. I don't know. They've remastered the hell out of all the Yakuzas. I'm sure there's some stuff like in the kind of same era as Vanquish of just like, I guess I want more AA stuff, you know, like I want more stuff that isn't, you know, their massive, like well-known IPs, but also isn't like super, you know, dumb deep cut Genesis stuff.
Billy
like
Hatcher. Somewhere in the middle.
Billy Hatcher.
Big old egghead. We need that. We need egghead. We got news this morning that Final Fantasy VII is going to get some news in the next month because they're gearing up for showcase.
It was news of news coming. News that news is happening.
Yeah, so we don't know what that means.
It's a countdown clock to a teaser website.
Yes.
Good. I mean,
about time. Yeah.
Yeah, that's better than knowing nothing, right?
Yeah. So you know, I'm really excited for that. I'm hyped for Remake Part 2. I loved Part 1. And
when was Part 1 out?
Part 1 was 2020. I want to say.
Wow. Yeah.
Because I want to say it was 2020, and then we got the Yuffie expansion 2021. Yep. I was not expecting that expansion to go as hard as it did. I cried during that expansion. Like it was the story was so like I knew what was going to happen, and I still it's just the storytelling was just done so well. I love what they've done with the remake, and I can't wait for part two. I'm very excited to see where the story picks up and how they, you know, kind of translate the open world stuff, because this one was very like kind of go where you want, but it's still kind of on rails. Like it was. Because it was all chapter based. Yeah. Which is funny because I always bring this up whenever somebody talks about tunnels in Final Fantasy. Like everybody complained about Final Fantasy 13 being all tunnels and stuff like that for the first half of the game. 7 was the same exact thing.
Right.
The exact same thing. So like I'm very excited to see where that goes. Obviously we've got 16 that's looming around the corner, so we're waiting to see what that's gonna, you know, shake out when we're gonna get that, hopefully this year as well. That would be a wonderful 2022 holiday. But with that, you know, we're gonna start wrapping up. What are you guys playing right now?
Elden Ring. Still just chipping away at that.
Yeah, I'm trying to think, because I played like 140 hours of Elden Ring, finished it, loved it, adored it, game of the year. And then I moved right on to like a Star Wars, which I played for way longer than I should have, because I didn't like that. You cannot 100% that game without like really going in and just giving it everything. It is, if you are like an obsessive collector type, which you probably are if you're buying like a Lego game based on Star Wars, one of the most collectible IPs ever made, proceed with caution, because that's like, if you're a completionist.
That game gave me a tummy ache. Like I definitely played, like I got my fill. Like I played a lot of it and had a really good time, and I was running around collecting everything, and then I just reached a point where I was like, this is not even like, this is not boring. This is this is aggressively not fun for me right now. I need to stop doing it. Like, it just became like this thing. And it's like, it's not the game. It's just that I played too much of it. Like, I kind of force fed myself and I was like, I'm full. I'm good.
It's very I'll come easy back later. To pull the little thread and be like, oh, so it's going to take me 45 minutes to unlock Ponda Baba. Okay, I'll go do that. All right. Well, I should get Dr. Evazon because they were at the bar together. Oh, that's going to take about a half an hour. Okay. But I mean, we can't have just like, you know, one of the jizz whalers singing by himself. So we'll unlock all of the Cantina band.
Gotta have a whole band.
Yeah, and I should get the Rancor Keeper, Malakili. And I just kept doing all this stuff and all of a sudden I was like, all right, there are like so many deep cut characters in this game that I cannot go for. And I just stop, just get up and walk away. So I stopped playing it, but I did enjoy my time with it. Maybe there'll be like a DLC thing that gets me back, but for now I've had my fill and I've just kind of been hopping around to a bunch of different games. I mentioned I got a Steam Deck before, so that's given me an opportunity to sort of just like play through tons of stuff that I've forgotten about. I'm playing Max Payne 3, for example.
Hell yeah.
Like, nice.
Yeah. And it's just like, I was like, oh man, like that's why I'm excited for like the PlayStation Plus stuff, because I like,
you're at this point where you're ready to browse and play a bunch of kind of eclectic.
Yeah. We're in this like weird lull with like big giant AAA open world ish games for a little while. Yeah.
Like, I feel like a lot of modern games are just really huge and they're a massive undertaking. Mm-hmm. And obviously that's not a bad thing, but you're not always in the mood for it. And I'm kind of down to dip into more linear stuff. Like Max Payne 3 sounds great. I just put up a feature of the history of chainsaws in video games, which is a very long,
go check that out.
A lot of chainsaws in games.
Really cool.
But I did a bunch of capture for that. And I was like jumping between different games. And I was messing around in Doom for the first time in like the old ones in years. And I was just like, this is kick's ass. This is a good time. I love to fight Satan in hell, you know. Like, it's cool. I don't know, like the original Quake, like, and those are things that are on Game Pass. I guess they're also Microsoft first party now, which is weird, but like smaller games, it's nice. It's nice to dip into that and be like, oh, check this out.
I'm going to finally commit to Hollow Knight, and I haven't done that yet. Because there's like, I aggressively dislike the first few hours of that game.
Oh, same here.
But everyone has told me like after that, it's like, it just keeps going. Not necessarily in a great way, because apparently it's like really long too. But
it is.
There's like, there's a bunch in the middle there that's like allegedly some of the best Metroidvania ever. And I've never really given it due diligence. And I want to do that.
See, I'm a big Metroidvania fan. Hollow Knight is just one that just did not stick with me. Like and mind you, I played through it because I started it when PS5 just came out. Mm-hmm. There wasn't a whole lot to play. I had already platinum Bugsnax. I was like, all right, I guess I'll play through Hollow Knight. And I'm like 99% through. I finished the game like mainlining it, but like there's this like pantheon of the gods where it's basically a boss rush,
right?
And you have to kill like 20 bosses with like no like three I think pit stops for healing, and it is just so brutally punishing, like difficulty wise and I get like 17, 18 in the way through it, and then I'll die and I'm just like, oh well, there goes an hour of my time, guess I'm restarting this 17, 18 bosses.
Okay, fine, you talk me out of it. I'm going to go back to Lego.
Play the main storyline. It's totally great. You don't have to do the Pantheon of the Gods stuff. It's totally extra just for platinum trophying hunters. You know, like if you want the platinum, you've got to do it. But otherwise, you're totally good. It's a good, solid Metroidvania. And a lot of people laud it for a lot of its, like, sequence breaking, but you can really kind of go and take things in any order you want, so it's kind of got a good variety for there. I think for me personally, obviously I've been playing a lot of Apex. I was talking earlier, I jumped into Curse of the Dead Gods, which was free on PS Plus this month.
I did that one.
That was a lot of fun. I played it on Switch when it first came out, and I was like, oh well, I'll just play it on my PlayStation now, and I am so much worse at it now on my PlayStation than I'm on my Switch for some reason. I do not understand how that works. I don't know if it's just the buttons are just kind of different. Like, I was used to playing it handheld on my Switch, and so I get something just resonated better on my Switch than I do for my PlayStation.
The buttons aren't as far away. There's a little tiny thumb movement involved.
That game was really cool. I feel like it came out a couple months or maybe like a year after Hades did.
Yeah.
And so like people had kind of gotten everything they needed from Hades, but I like that felt like a nice holdover. Like if you wanted more stuff like Hades, that was
yes.
It's really cool.
Yep. Cool. And then anything you guys want to plug? Anything that you guys are?
No, I mean, I just want to thank the audience for sticking with us for 750 episodes, which is utterly insane. Some of you have been here from the start. Some of you joined recently. Some of you, this will be the last episode you ever listen to because it was just, you just hated every second of it. And you
I think they probably the stopped glasses. Listening by now, you know?
It's I don't know. Some people just got to finish something before they know it's bad.
The show really gets good after the first three seasons. And picks up. Just got to get past that intro. Yeah, segment.
The first 60 hours of Beyond, right? After that, it gets great.
They start killing off hosts. It's weird. Thank you. This is like, on a personal level, it's awesome to be back in the studio recording a show with my friends again. That's been... I missed that. And there was a while there where I wasn't sure if we'd ever really do that. Everybody kind of scattered to the wind when the pandemic hit. And we literally didn't have an office for a while. We had people being like, how come you're still shooting videos in your dumb bedroom with your garbage behind you? And I'm like, well, I like this garbage. But also because like we literally didn't have an office to come to. And now we do. We're building things back up. And it feels like we work at a startup company out there. But it's fun. So we're getting there. So thank you for listening. Thanks for rocking with us and being part of the show, because it rules.
Yeah. Awesome. No, what he said. That's
what he
good.
Said.
I was going to watch Max's Chainsaw.
Yeah, I was going to plug that. Please go watch that. And also, if you haven't, my show Kitbash Creatures, where I make things out of other stuff. I made an Elden Ring one that we put up before Elden Ring, and I feel like nobody watched it because of that. But I made the little pot man. The pot for
Alexander.
It's not Alexander. It's like a little baby. It's a little baby.
It's a little
one.
Baby pot.
I don't know what it might as well be Alexander. Baby jar. Yeah. Alexander has like he's kind of got like a more of a like a torso, you know? It's like
know a big urn.
I feel like you just need to put more bodies into the baby pot, and then it'll become more, Alexander.
What is it, like soiled meat dumplings or whatever?
Did you put anything in there?
I put some snack mix in there, and then I realized that there's like styrofoam shavings, and I probably shouldn't eat that. So.
Well, awesome. Max, Brian, it was wonderful having you guys on. Thank you to our audience. Thank you to Red behind the scenes. It's been a wonderful 750. I hope I get to host more often, because I really like hosting.
Yeah.
So, you know, you're Jonathon, go parasailing and parachuting off mountains more often, because then I get to do this, especially when Mark's not here. And we'll see if he makes it back next week. I do miss Mark, because he brings an element of chaos to the show. But it's it's nice having the limelight.
Yeah. If you, if you want, tweet at Mark and say, I hope, Splash Mountain is working and you could get down from the top of the waterfall.
Actually, it's probably too confusing for him to read, 'cause he's up there and it's the glare. Just send him pictures of Splash Mountain.
That's
you know, so that'll be easier for him to understand what's going on.
That's Mark Medina. Send him tons of pictures. So you can, the animatronics too, you know, the aforementioned Br'er Rabbit is always a good crowd pleaser.
But for Beyond, I am Jada_Arena. Brian is Agent Bizzle.
That's right.
And Max is, I do not know your Twitter handle.
Just Max Scoville.
Max Scoville. There we go. He keeps it easy for me.
Having an unimaginative day when I made those things.
You know what? Hey, simplicity is best. So from all three of us, you guys, thank you very much. And Beyond.
Beyond.